Okay, so the second one is I make the claim that evolution, biological evolution is a true, is true. It's a fact, and your criticism is.
Well, that you just make that categorical statement that is true. Everything that you say in the treatise is based on the assumption that it's dogmatically, irrefutably, non-debatably true. And so therefore, if that foundation is can crumble, then the whole treatise crumbles, the whole 10 pages crumbles. There are plenty of erudite, academic, scholarly, PhD, scientists and theologians and philosophers who do not hold to biological evolution for a number of reasons. Now, they tip their hat to the evidence that suggests it, as I do, as people who are intelligent, who are well-thinking, who are well-intentioned, and they're honest with the facts. They can look at the evolutionary hypothesis and say, yeah, there are things that here that are hard for me to argue with. And there are things that would suggest that that the people who hold to that theory are not, they're not ignorant. They're intelligent people looking for the same answers that the rest of us are. But for you to assert that it's dogmatically, irrevocably, irrefutably true, non-debatably true, is again an overstatement and a massive assertion. There are plenty of scientists, theologians, philosophers who say, now wait a minute, there are other things that would suggest otherwise. And so this is what I'm, for lack of a better word, attacking in your treatise. Your whole argument is based on the assumption that evolutionary is just the evolutionary hypothesis is just true, done deal, non-debatable.
Well, yeah, personally, I do think it's a fact, and I mentioned in the booklet an evangelical Christian, Dennis Venema. He's a scientist at a Christian university, and he basically is trying to inform his fellow evangelicals about the evidence for evolution and just the DNA of it. I find it's so overwhelming that I think most viewers of this are going to, I mean, I think most viewers. Who are academics maybe even might even look at this and say, how could we take seminaries even seriously if you can't accept evolution? I mean, with modern in today's modern world, this just seems crazy. Just I'm trying to be respectful here, but it just seems crazy to doubt that humans evolved from other animals. So you're saying
Well,
that you think there's a possibility that humans not descend from other animals?
what my argument is that you are making a categorical statement that evolutionary hypothesis is absolutely true. I am not contending that there's no evidence for it. And there are plenty of Christians who do, and you acknowledge this in your treatise. There are plenty of Christians who do hold to the evolutionary hypothesis. They're called theistic evolutionists, as you well know. And these are people who believe that God did it, but they can't settle the issue in their mind that all of this, what seems like design and creativity and the advancement of intelligence and so forth, is just the result of a bunch of random accidents through, that something had to be guiding the process. The evolutionary hypothesis, though, is that everything is just a bunch of random accidents or chemistry happening, and the good outweighs the bad, the survival of the fittest, and so forth. I'm not arguing that there isn't evidence for evolution. I'm arguing that to say that it is categorically non-debatable is an overstatement, and that's what my friends and people that I associate with would concur with. That there are many of us that would tip our hats and say, "Yes, science has come a long way, baby," and we can't argue all points. But to assume then that because evolution has some merit scientifically, that there is no God, that there is no author of evolution or creation or whatever all of this comes from, again, is an overstatement and a little bit extreme for people to conclude that when they have no evidence for such a conclusion, that there is no cause of the evolutionary process or the creation process.
Okay, let's back up a little bit and let me sidestep the issue or the question about whether evolution could be God-guided or if it's 100% natural or not. Let's just say biological evolution, one definition of it might be that humans descended from other animals. I would say that is a fact. Now, would you say that is not a fact, that humans descended from other animals?
Well, I would say that I'm not comfortable with it as a human being. I see a clear distinction between me and other animals, and when you look at the fossil record, what you see is, if there are human forms, hominids, and there certainly are those that exist, the people that would say that these are indeed human forms, they still look more like human beings than anything else. They might have variations of skull, but they tend to be human, more than anything else. So for me to say, well, that is a man evolving from some type of an ape-like creature, again, is a guess at best, and even scientists will acknowledge that much. They don't say categorically that we know exactly what this half-ape, half-person, or whatever it was, and what their life tendencies were. They say all of this is theory, speculation, and our best guess based upon what we can see in the record. So I'm not comfortable saying I can say for certain that I know that we evolved from other type of animal. I can say that there's a huge distinction between humans now and animals now, and if we evolved from them, it's a pretty impressive feat.
Well, I don't think the distinction is really relevant to anything. I mean, for example, we came from other apes, and if you go back far enough, we came from fish, and of course right. There's a distinction between fish and humans, but what's sure. That have to do with evolution?
Well, I mean, again, if you believe that evolution is categorically, undeniably true, then it has nothing to do with it. But if those of us who bring that into question and say there are other theories, there are other constructs, there are other ideas about how humankind got here, then of course we're going to bring into question, because obviously atheistic evolution is contrary to the faith that we hold. So we're not going to just wave a white flag and say, well, there you go, but all the science says it's true, so therefore it is. And the reason for that is because atheism is so fatalistic. It offers no hope. Even in your own document, you say that when we're dead, that's it. We're no more valuable than a blade of grass. This is your own words. You said this. That we have our
no,
moment.
I didn't say valuable.
Well, I know, but you said we have our moment, and then we die. Yes. Just like a blade of grass. Well, I think
Jesus said that too,
Yeah, well, but not quite that way, and you know it. The point is that we have value to life, and for us to assume that this is our only shot at it, and there's so much more to us in our emotional, spiritual, the love that we carry with us, all these things, to assume that that's just a chemical thing that fades away when we physically die, that is a hopeless, fatalistic philosophy that causes people to say, my conscience won't let me buy into the fatalism of biological evolution. So facts aside, whatever data you want to get from the scientific facts, it goes against human nature, and we want to say that there's value in human nature, as you want to say there's value in the DNA structure and the scientific structure. That's all fine and good, but it devalues the importance of the human person. And to say that we're nothing more valuable than anything that lives and dies, whether it be a blade of grass or a leaf or a goldfish. We want to think that we are the hallmark of God's creation.
Okay, I think your conversation is kind of mixing up maybe philosophy that is a consequence of evolution versus the science evolution.
It has
to. Do we both agree? I think the highest value should be the truth, and we need to deal with the truth, whether it's happy or good or not.
But you don't know that you have the truth. That's my point.
Okay, but I mean, I think we do. I think we do.
Yeah, you say you do, and you say you think that you do, but that doesn't mean that you do.
Sure. Okay, so now, again, if I have the definition of biological evolution as just common descent, which means all the humans descended from other apes and, et cetera, down to fish and everything, if I leave that as the as a definition of evolution, and you said there's good alternatives to that, really isn't the only alternative is just God created humans from a miracle, from scratch?
Well, that's obviously the traditional evangelical view. The young earth creationist view. I will concede that there are obviously millions of Christians who are not in that camp, who are not in the camp of instantaneous six-day creation.
Well, also the old earthers, they also reject human evolution, so they also believe in special...
Well, not all of them. They believe in different variations of it. But they do hold firmly to the idea of a special creation, that God viewed us as the hallmark, the apex of his creation. That's what his word says. And the reason we hold so dearly to it, again, philosophically, it's more comforting to us, because atheistic evolution is fatalistic. And human nature, something inside of human nature wants to live. We don't want to die. There's no joy in the thought of death. This is the reason we exercise, we eat right, we take nutritional supplements, we go to the doctor when we're sick. Life is important.
Yeah, I think that's just called a survival instinct. We were bred.
But survival in the here and now and in the afterlife, whatever it may be, the desire for life and eternal life is innate in human nature. That's why it's in every part of every religion, that's part of every culture on the face of the earth, and it always has been, and it always will be, because that is human nature.
Okay, so to back up again and to rephrase, if biological evolution was just common descent, that humans came from other animals, you know, forget about how, whether it was God-guided or not, or totally natural, but if biological evolution is just that humans came from other animals, another alternative is that God made humans from scratch by a miracle. Is there any other alternatives?
Well, not from my perspective. I mean, you know, I I'm not a Christian apologist, and I'm not a Christian scientist, so I'm not in a position to debate the depth of that dialogue, except to say that those two seem to be the only options. Either we evolved from something, or God put us here in the form that we are in now. I am most comfortable with the fact that God put us here in the form that we are now, because, again, it's not fatalistic. It seems to have purpose. It seems to value who I am. It seems to say God had a special place for me and all of humanity in his creation of us. So it feels better. It feels more natural. It's in line with my human nature. It's not contrary to who I see myself as, or who any human being sees himself as, something special in the eyes of God.
Okay, so I basically see as biological descent as a fact, and you don't. So I guess we'll leave it at that for now.
Okay,
we'll go on to the next one.
Yeah, it's not, well, what I say is it's not debate. It's not a non-debatable fact. Yeah, we can debate.
Okay.
We need to get onto the problem, don't we?
Yeah, but I mean, just in summary, I mean, I think the DNA evidence overwhelmingly both shows that evolution happened. You know, for example, for what they call pseudogenes is a strong argument for me. Uh-huh. And then also, if we were created separately, I think that would also be shown in the DNA. But instead, we see signs of descent again with the pseudogenes.
Well,
so to me, I think. So I mean, for me, I think we both see signs of descent plus the hypothesis that we are created uniquely. Right. Not from the animals, I think, is also shown, but...
Well, as Ronald Reagan said to Jimmy Carter, there you go again.
Yeah, right.
You said, you know, another one of your overstatements, I think the science overwhelmingly supports. Again, that is an overstatement. It's your opinion, but the science is certainly not overwhelmingly in that camp. It can be debated. There are plenty of people who would say the science that proves creationism is overwhelming. So... you don't get to have that one and say it's absolutely true. It's there you go again.
Okay. Well, we could talk about this much longer, just like the first one. So, but just to make it interesting, I think we'll move on to the next one.
There you go.
Okay, so this is